Amen. I hear somebody say yes. I hear somebody say yes. God is in the house today. Thank you for taking us to the mountain today. Not just the hills. You've taken us to the mountain today, from where our strength comes from. Today I have a question for us as individuals and as a congregation. And it's this: if we really, really, no holds barred, trusted God, what would God do through us as a congregation? If we truly stepped beyond our fears, if we truly were healed in those broken places and stepped out, what would God do through us? This month we're looking at our aspirations as a congregation, and they are bold and they are big and they are a challenge, and they address so many of our hopes and our dreams. But I think God has even bigger aspirations for us. If we truly release ourselves into fully trusting our God. And then think about it individually. What would God do through you if you fully, 100% trusted God? Imagine trusting God with every fiber of your being. What kind of risk are you willing to take on God? I believe that our God is the God of Jeremiah, who says, "I know the plans I have for you. Plans for good, plans for healing, plans for power as you trust." So I invite us today to fully release ourselves, to trust ourselves, and to trust God, and to lean into a God who is trustworthy, a God who has our back, a God who has our life. Our strategic plan talks about the songs of imagining, singing those songs, and our scripture today is a song of imagining that the people sang on their way to Zion. They knew that their God was like Mount Zion, who would protect them and keep them. Now, they were afraid, and they had plenty of reasons to be afraid. Trusting God does not mean you're not afraid. Trusting God means you're real about your fears, and then you take the step and you trust God anyway. Our scriptures today are woven together with these themes of trust. A people who sang the song from the bottom of their heart on the way to Zion, knowing who their God is, knowing that God had their back and God had their lives. What if we really trusted that God was speaking in us and through us? Our scriptures today are full of this idea of what it means to really trust. And in the scripture today, we see the Shunammite woman who saw this one passing through town. And a voice said to her, "Invite him home for dinner." Now, that's the kind of thing that anybody could easily say, that can't be the voice of God. Why would I invite a complete stranger into my home for dinner? But that voice wouldn't go away. She trusted the voice, and she invited who turned out to be the prophet Elisha into her home. Something began to grow from that act of faith, that act of trust, taking that risk on hospitality. She didn't know that she was hosting a prophet and hosting an angel. She didn't know that in those moments of stepping out in her faith, God was up to something that would change both of their lives in amazing, miraculous ways. She said to her loved one, another voice was inviting her to build a room, an upper room, with a desk, a lamp, a place to rest. You see, we trust by abiding with the trustworthy one. We build trust by abiding with the Creator. And so she built this abiding room where the prophet could go. And in that place, trust began to build. Trust began to grow. God was released through that risk. Jesus, the trustworthy one. In our scripture today, we see him going to a quiet place to pray. And from that place of quiet becomes the capacity to heal. Scripture says that Jesus' healing powers became so well known that the people gathered around the door where he was staying. Word was out. As we fully step into our trust in the name of Jesus, imagine what God will do in this place. Imagine that biblical story being echoed in our day, in this neighborhood, in this time. Imagine MCCDC being known as a place where God is and God is in God's people and healing happens. A place where brokenness becomes wholeness. In the scripture, there's just one door where people were gathering. But even in this room, you can just count the doors. Imagine the whole city lining up at these doors, wanting in, because in this place, God is at work and our God is a healing God. Imagine if we really believed that, really trusted that, and it came from the very depths of who we are. How do we grow in our trust? We get close to the trustworthy one, the one who has our back, the one who has our lives, the one who helps us to sing these songs of imagining. It's important to tell our stories of how we've come to a place of trust, how we've made it through fearful times. And today I am so pleased that sharing the pulpit with me is Cathy Batson, who has a story of faith and trust, who will take us to that upper room where we will grow in our trust.
Thank you. My mother's name was Lucy Mae Batson. I adored her. I worshiped the very ground she walked on. Lucy Mae was very stoic. She always held her head high and her shoulders back. She was just a little bit taller than I am. However, she always appeared to be 7 feet tall to us. When I was about 5 years old and not ready to go to school yet, my mother would stay at home with me all day, and she was a domestic worker. She ironed clothes for the white families in our little town. On this particular day, if I close my eyes, I can see it clearly. My mother had me in the living room. We called it the front room back then. She had me sitting at the little table. Y'all remember them little tables with the little chairs, and that was a children's table. As she was ironing, she had me working on my alphabet. And she would say to me, "Now, show me what you've written." And I would say, "Yes, ma'am." And I'd hold up my paper. And she said, "You know," my mother always wore an apron. She said, "You know, that's a little A. I told you to make a capital A. Now you do that again." And I'd say, "Yes, ma'am." Just around that time, we looked out and there was a white lady coming up the walk. She was walking very briskly. She had a scowl on her face, and I could tell she wasn't happy. In her arms, she held the shirts that my mother had ironed for her earlier that week. My mother met her at the door. She said, "Lucy," I never forget the feeling. I felt uneasy. I wasn't used to people calling my mother Lucy other than my father. She said, "Lucy." My mother said, "Yes, ma'am." Time stood still for a moment. I didn't recognize her. She began to shrink in that moment. I became afraid. She said, "Lucy, I told you to put starch in those shirts, and They didn't have any starch. And my mother said, "Yes, ma'am." And she took a step back. The lady walked in without being invited, and I was taken aback once again. No one ever entered our house unless my mother allowed them in. And she stepped through the threshold without permission. And my mother took a step back. And she appeared very small. She said, "I'll have those finished by the end of the day." My mom said that, and she looked down, and the lady said, "Yeah, I'll be back." My mother said, "Yes, ma'am," and she shrunk even more. She appeared to crawl inside herself. As the lady walked away, my mother went over to the record player. We called it the hi-fi. She took out her favorite album, her favorite artist, Mahalia Jackson. My mom would often put her on when she needed to find her center, when she was disturbed about something, when she was worried. She took out Mahalia Jackson and she paused for a minute. And she went somewhere. She put on in the upper room. And she stood for a moment. And she looked. And I went to her. Because I knew she went somewhere. And whatever my mama was going, I was going too. She wasn't going to leave me. I went to her and I said, "Mommy," she had no words for me. All she could do was cup me. And she rocked with me. And I went where she went and she was transfixed. Because, y'all don't understand, because she had to find herself. She had to come back to herself. And so she put on in the upper room so that she could connect to a higher source. Please take this journey with me in the upper room.
The upper room where Jesus sat in that hill, blessed. Daily there my sin confessing, begging for his mercy. His love in prayer.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Hallelujah.
Yes. Amen. Amen. All right. Amen. Yes, yes. Yes, yes. Fill us up, God. Fill us up. Fill us up. Fill us up. Yes. Yes, yes. Fill us up, God. Yes. Right now, we're in the upper room, and we can walk with pride today. We can walk with healing. We can walk with wholeness. We can dance that dance of trust and that dance of faith. So now, if you want to spend some time in that upper room, we're going to be here to pray with you. If you want to spend some time in the upper room, we have some oil. We have a kneeler. You can be in the upper room right there where you are today. So let us just be in that place today of knowing who God is. This is a trust-deepening room, a trust-deepening time. Those who abide close to God abide with the trustworthy one, the healing one, the life-giving one. So let us stay in that upper room. Please rise as you're able, in body or in spirit, as the pastoral care ministers come forward. And this is your time, our time with God.